Listening Library presents The Great Brain at the Academy by John D. Fitzgerald. Read for you by Jason Culp. For Right Reverend Monsignor A.F. Giovannoni. Chapter 1. Tom Spots a Card Shark. When my brother Tom began telling people in Aidenville, Utah, that he had a great brain, everybody laughed at him, including his own family. We all thought he was trying to play some kind of a kid's joke on us. But after he had used his great brain to swindle all the kids in town and make fools of a lot of grown-ups, nobody laughed at my brother anymore. I think that was why just about everybody in town, except his own family, was glad to see Tom leave Aidenville on September 1st, 1897. And I couldn't help thinking that Papa must have felt kind of relieved too, although he didn't show it. Papa was editor and publisher of the Aidenville Weekly Advocate and was considered one of the smartest men in town. But some of the shenanigans Tom had pulled with his great brain were enough to make Papa feel like a blooming idiot. Now he wouldn't have to worry about men dropping into his office to complain that Tom had swindled their sons. Mama cried a lot at the depot, but she also must have felt at least a little relief. She wouldn't have to worry for the next 9 months about mothers telephoning her to complain about Tom. The truth of the matter, though, was that although Tom had been a junior-grade confidence man since he was 8 years old, he had never really cheated anybody. With his great brain, he simply devised schemes that made people swindle themselves. Tom and my eldest brother Sven were bound for the Catholic Academy for Boys in Salt Lake City. We only had a one-room schoolhouse in Aidenville, where Mr. Standish taught the first through the sixth grades. Any parents wanting their kids to get a higher education had to send them to Salt Lake City. Tom was only 11, going on 12, but so smart that Mr. Standish had let him skip the fifth grade. Sven was 2 years older and going back to the academy for his second year. A stranger who saw us three brothers together would never have guessed we were related. Sven looked like our Danish-American mother, with blonde hair and a light complexion. I had dark, unruly hair and dark eyes, just like Papa. Tom didn't look like either Mama or Papa, unless you sort of put them together, and he was the only one in the family who had freckles. Tom promised to write to me every week. The first letter I received told me how he had spotted a card shark on the train. I didn't find out all the details, though, until my brothers came home for Christmas vacation. Then I got Sven to tell me what had happened, and later Tom told me what had happened. But there was something wrong. Sven didn't mention several things Tom told me, and Tom didn't mention his invention for trains, which Sven told me all about. That is why I figure the only way to tell what really happened is to put their stories together and tell it in my own way. Tom admitted he felt down in the dumps as the train pulled out of Aidenville. I couldn't blame him. It was the first time he had ever been away from home. I knew when I became old enough to go to the academy that I would probably bawl like a baby. "Go ahead and cry," Sven said as the train left the depot. "It is nothing to be ashamed about. I know I did last year, my first time away from home." Tom sure wanted to cry, but he wasn't going to give Sven the satisfaction of knowing it. "Maybe I don't feel like crying," he lied. "Pardon me," Sven said sarcastically. "I just thought being separated from Mom and Dad and our kid brother for the first time might make you feel sad." "Well, I know something that will make you cry. You won't be able to swindle the kids at the academy and get away with shenanigans like you pulled in Aidenville. Those Jesuit priests are strict." Sven's superior big brother attitude was beginning to get on Tom's nerves. "You are just jealous of my great brain," he said. "It is warm in here. I'm going to open a window." You do, and you'll get a cinder in your eye, Sven said. That was enough to make Tom open the window, even if he got 10 cinders in his eyes. He had never let Sven boss him around at home, and he wasn't about to start now. Sure enough, he got a cinder in his eye. He pulled his head inside quickly and shut the window. What did I tell you? Sven said. Take the corner of your handkerchief and get it out, Tom said. Say please, Sven said, smiling and pretending he enjoyed seeing Tom suffer. Never mind, Tom said. I'll go to the washroom and get it out myself. I was just joking, Sven said, taking out his handkerchief. He got the cinder out of Tom's eye just as the conductor came into the coach. The conductor was a big, ruddy-faced man wearing the traditional blue uniform and cap with a big gold watch chain across his vest. When he came to them, he took their tickets and placed two blue stubs under the metal tabs on the seats. Then he looked at Tom's red eye. I see it didn't take you long to learn not to open a window on a train, Sonny, he said. Being called Sonny always made Tom angry.
My name is Tom Fitzgerald, not Sonny, he said. And I can't help wondering why they don't put screens on coach windows so passengers won't get cinders in their eyes.
Well now, Tom Fitzgerald, the conductor said, it just so happens that on the newer coaches on the main line, we do have screens on the windows. But you still can't open a window when the train is moving.
Why not? Tom asked.
Smoke from the locomotive would get into the passenger cars, the conductor said.
They could fix it so all windows could be opened without any cinders or smoke getting into the passenger cars, Tom said, although he didn't have the least idea of exactly how it could be done.
And just how would they do that? The conductor asked. I'm sure the president of this railroad and of every other railroad would be delighted to know.
Tom didn't miss seeing the conductor wink at the other passengers. He tapped his index finger to his temple. I'll put my great brain to work on it, he said, and let you know when you finish collecting tickets.
I'll be back, the conductor said. I wouldn't miss hearing this for the world.
All the passengers in the coach except Sven began to laugh. Sven felt so embarrassed that he slid way down in his seat. You have only been on this train for about 10 minutes, he said, and you've already made us the laughingstock of everybody in this coach.
They won't be laughing very long, Tom said, confident that his great brain would not let him down.
You must be plumb loco, Sven said with disgust. They have engineers with years of experience designing trains. If there was any way to open windows without getting cinders and smoke into the passenger cars, they would have invented it.
Do you think that made Tom give up? Heck no.
The men who built Conestoga wagons and prairie schooners never thought of putting brakes on them, he said. Thousands of emigrants who came west had to chain their rear wheels when going down a grade. Then one day, one of them got tired of chaining his wheels. He used a shovel handle, a couple of 2x4s to make a lever, a wooden block, a piece of rope, and the sole of one of his old shoes, and made a brake for his wagon. Now please be quiet while I put my great brain to work.
Tom's great brain must have been working like 60, because when the conductor returned, he was ready. Here I am, Tom Fitzgerald, the conductor said with a smile on his ruddy face. Now tell me how we can open windows on trains without getting cinders or smoke in the cars.
Tom wasn't about to divulge his plan for nothing. When he put his great brain to work, he expected to be paid for it. I'll expect some financial reward if the railroad uses my idea, he said.
Naturally, the conductor said. And you have all these passengers as witnesses that it was your idea.
They could run a pipe from the smokestack on the locomotive along the top of the train to the caboose, Tom said, and let all the cinders and smoke out behind the train.
I'm afraid that wouldn't work,
the conductor said. The pipe would break when the train went around a curve.
Not if they put flexible couplings on it between each car, Tom said.
A salesman across the aisle began to laugh. I think the boy has you there, conductor, he said. No, he hasn't, the conductor said. With such a long pipe, the fire under the boiler in the locomotive would go out.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.